Hey friends, you know that Azure Stack enables you to run Azure services in your data center, even if that data center is on a ship at sea. But don't think of it as a replacement for Azure, it's an extension to Azure. I'm here with Ultan Kinahan to learn about it today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it's another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Ultan, and we're going to talk about Azure Stack. This is some hybrid cloud possibilities. So, the hybrid cloud, what does that mean?
Hybrid cloud really is the ability to bring Azure services into your data center. Mm-hmm. So we've released Azure Stack. We're coming up on almost a year now. Hmm. We released it last September at Ignite down in Florida. And you know, the momentum around this has been tremendous. It has clearly been a hard requirement for customers out there to have Azure services in their data centers to meet regulatory requirements, like just workload requirements, latency, lots of different issues that we've come across. Mm-hmm. Lots of workloads that have just really kind of surprised us as well. The thoughts of Azure Stack, on a ship sailing at sea in a desert on trucks, all sorts of really kind of bizarre scenarios, but it's fantastic to see that we're able to meet those needs of our customers.
So it's like Azure on the move on an oil rig somewhere.
It is, exactly, yeah. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Which is really quite fascinating.
So this isn't a replacement for Azure. This isn't for someone who says, I can't use Azure.
Absolutely not. No, we've had conversations like this. If customers come to us and ask for those needs as well, to be honest, we try to deflect them back to something like Hyper-V or something, which is better suited for those requirements, which are just virtualization workloads.
Sure.
Stack is Azure. So, we're bringing pure Azure services into your data center. Like IaaS capabilities, yes, but more importantly, the PaaS capabilities. So that's what we really want to try and position and just kind of direct customers in the appropriate way.
I was meeting with a large customer recently, and they were telling me that in order to get a virtual machine in their data center, they had to actually fax IT for permission.
Yep.
And then they would go and install IIS and do all this kind of stuff to put a web app on it.
Right.
But when we think about Azure, we think about something that is elastic, that is programmatic.
Yep.
So being able to go and do the same kind of right-click, publish, and get deploys and stuff to Azure App Service.
It is, yeah.
But it's on a piece of hardware I can touch.
Absolutely.
That's really interesting, because the cloud, when you think of the cloud, it's not something you can visit.
Yes, correct. Yep. So, it's a complete game changer for us, bringing those capabilities to customers. But what's really cool, what we've done is we've integrated this with Visual Studio as well. So, we're all familiar with how you can go and very easily deploy from Visual Studio to Azure. Mm-hmm. We've now replicated that for Azure Stack. So we even have an Azure Stack repo where you can go and pull all of the pre-canned templates and immediately start building solutions. Now, those templates can be deployed to either Azure or Azure Stack.
Okay, so ARM, the Azure Resource Manager, exists in both places because it is Azure.
Absolutely. So we've taken the code from Azure, plugged that into Azure Stack to enable that identical ecosystem. Mm-hmm. So it's the same portal experience, same look and feel. And then even from the DevOps side, like Visual Studio, et cetera, you can then easily just deploy to either endpoint.
Mm-hmm. So, well, Azure moves fast. The Azure APIs move fast. The versioning of what's going on in those APIs moves fast. Yep. And it can move fast because it can also be backwards compatible.
Yep.
But I would assume if I were going to have an Azure Stack in my office, I might not want it to move so fast. So I would assume that the versions may not necessarily line up.
They do not line up. No. So Azure Stack is behind the most current builds of Azure.
And
On purpose. Mm. And to be honest, I'm not sure I ever see them lining up in full parity. Some of the services might.
Yeah. Or if only for a moment, and then one would be. Yeah.
Yes, because we are, as Microsoft, an Azure first company as well. Everything we build is going to be for Azure first and will later trickle down to Azure Stack. But all of the services that are going to come to Azure Stack are also based on customer demand. Mm-hmm. So it's quite interesting to see what's coming in. Like IoT is a really, really big one, heavy ask from all of our customers out there. When you think about oil fields, oil rigs and ships and certain scenarios, IoT is required to light up a lot of those capabilities. So a few months ago, we did announce IoT Hub is coming to Azure Stack. Mm-hmm. And so that's going to drop at some point in the not too distant future. Mm-hmm. And that's actually going to bring other services as well that are requirements for IoT Hub, things like Cosmo DB, stuff like that.
So it's complementary services. So the customer says, I want IoT Hub on Azure Stack, and say, well, these are the three or four services that are most complementary that make IoT Hub shine.
Yep.
We'll bring them all over.
Or more so required for IoT to Hub to be able to operate.
Mm-hmm. So, now, is this something that I'm going to take some machines I've got lying around and have Azure? It seems like Azure would need to be more formal.
Absolutely.
In its requirements.
Absolutely more formal. The only way to get this is to go through your favorite OEM.
Okay.
So, yeah, we're very public about who we're with. We're with HP, Lenovo, Cisco, Huawei, and there's a bunch of them out there that we're working with.
Okay.
They're the ones that are going to deliver your Azure Stack to you. So once you go and buy your Azure Stack through the OEM, they'll actually come install this. They'll rack it, configure it, and integrate that into your network.
Seriously.
And then hand you the keys to your cloud.
What's it look like? Do you have a picture of the stack?
I do, absolutely. So here is just kind of like a breakdown of what this kind of looks like. Mm-hmm. So we start with the redundant power supplies. They're going to be in all configurations. Then we have the redundant top of rack switches up here as well. So, and they're going to be 10, 20, 40 gig connectivity.
And I'm guessing, just because of what you've said in the last two items, that redundant is going to come up multiple times.
Redundant is going to come up multiple times, but interesting that you asked that, because these two next ones, the BMC, which is a baseboard management controller, is not redundant, mm-hmm. nor is the HLH. These two pieces of the configuration, we don't really feel that they need to be redundant.
Okay.
They're not going to impact any workloads. If one of them goes offline or we lose one, we can just very easily replace it.
I see. So things that need to be redundant, that are obviously redundant, are clearly redundant, like power supplies and top of rack switches.
Absolutely. Okay. And then from there, we just add all the nodes to the configuration as well. And we have quite a large matrix of what we can support in there. It starts at 4 physical servers and scales up to 16. It's 12 today, but we're going to 16 very shortly. And then you can have configurations from 12 to 28 cores, from 256 gigs of RAM up to 1.5 terabytes of RAM per node. Mm-hmm. So you can actually build this thing out quite large. Mm-hmm. A lot of customers ask as well, that's not enough. We are working to bring multiple scale units to this as well. So what we're looking at here, this picture is actually diagramming a scale unit or a physical rack of servers.
Okay.
And we're going to be able to add multiple racks of servers to your own personal region of Azure in the future.
And that's kind of a great way to put it. I like that, my own personal region. I put things in West US, and then I might put things in Hanselman Kitchen.
Yeah.
And just have a rack right there next to the fridge.
Absolutely.
Now, you're saying that I can have, 4 as a minimum, or up to 16 in a single rack. I assume as a company I could start out with 4.
Absolutely.
And have some empty space in my rack and then fill it in if I want to as well.
You can, absolutely. And that's something that we're having to work and guide customers through quite heavily, is sizing correctly.
Hmm.
People look at this very frequently, say, well, 4 servers is not enough. The reality is it might be enough, like if you actually break your application apart and look at this correctly. We don't want to just subscribe unnecessarily.
Mm-hmm. Well, how much care and feeding does this require? I know that when people, some personalities, some companies culturally want total control, and they put that in there so that they can know everything of it. But this is kind of a nice balance. You control the hardware, but do you have to care about the software? Does Azure heal itself, fix itself, upgrade itself?
It has all of the self-healing capabilities you would expect, all kind of, like, there's a tremendous amount of automation built into the Azure Stack platform.
Mm.
Now, when you buy this, you're actually buying services as well from Microsoft and from your OEM.
Mm.
We will take care of this platform for you. Any issues arise, you pick up the phone, you call Microsoft. We'll go through a process of allowing us access to your system for a small period of time in order to be able to remediate the issues.
Mm-hmm. Right, this is not just a pile of VMs.
It's not at all. So yes, we have all of that underneath the covers, but you have to learn about creating offers and plans and managing the capacity. These are the things that we do at Microsoft on the Azure public cloud that people just have never really seen.
Oh, that's really interesting. So you just made me think about, when you said plans, I think of app services, and as someone that uses app services extensively, I make app service plans, which is kind of the VM underneath, but it's really more of a capacity planning thing.
Exactly.
That plan, a basic or a standard or premium, might not be what big company needs. They would make their own plan.
Exactly, yeah. And when you go and sign up with Azure, you'll be familiar with going in, creating a new subscription. You're going to subscribe to an offer. Our offers in Azure are basically a la carte. You can spin up any service you wish to do. An organization might have a different view on that. They might want just an IaaS plan, a database plan, an app service plan, et cetera. So you can create your own offers specifically around those services and capabilities.
You mentioned that it does ARM and it does Visual Studio. Do you have
yes.
a demo of that?
I do, absolutely. So let's bounce out of this and jump right over into my Azure Stack. So here, what I actually really quickly like to do is I typically start in the Azure portal. So
okay.
we can see it's the Azure portal right up here in the top left.
It looks like the Azure portal.
Yeah, absolutely. But now we jump into Azure Stack, the name changes right here. So we're in, it's the same ecosystem, very same experience, touch and feel, et cetera.
Does that mean I can go AZ, log in, and use all the same tools and call the same APIs I'm used to using?
You can. It's a, like we have different commandlets for Azure Stack.
Mm-hmm.
So we have our own PowerShell modules. So it's like AZS versus AZ,
stuff
like that. So yeah, absolutely.
Cool.
And then, so this is the tenant portal that you know, your typical users in your organization would use.
Mm-hmm.
Then we also have this brand new dashboard, which is the administration dashboard.
Mm.
This is something that doesn't exist in Azure,
mm-hmm.
built specifically for Azure Stack. But here, you know, if you take a look down the blade on the left side here,
mm-hmm.
we've create offers, plans, manage capacity, my region management, so I can have multiple regions theoretically right here, marketplace management, et cetera.
So there's a terabyte of RAM.
Yes. Yes.
That's just lovely. This
Very
is the part
good.
Where I ask you for a review unit that you can ship over to my kitchen and I will have a stack in my house.
Absolutely. Shoot me an email.
All right. So, so it is Azure. This means I actually am sitting here and I realize I already know the Azure Stack.
Absolutely.
Because I already know Azure. I understand the portal.
You do. So it's a very easy experience to kind of translate into, to bring into your environment and kind of onboard to. It is the administration piece where there's just some learnings have to happen there.
Mm-hmm.
But we will work very closely with all the customers onboarding on this as well to make sure that transition is smooth and that they understand the process.
Cool. Well, then in closing, let's do something cool in Visual Studio.
Absolutely. So pull up Studio here. So I have something already kind of pre-built just to save us some time here.
All right.
But what I've done is I've pulled a template in here from the Azure Stack GitHub repo. So all of these are pre-built, predefined. And this one here, it's a very simple one where it's going to deploy just a virtual network. But one thing I do like to call out here is something we talked about a few minutes ago is this API version.
Mm.
So this is different. Now, why this is so important is when you're developing for Azure and Azure Stack, you want to be sure that you're developing towards the right API versions.
Mm-hmm.
That way you don't have hiccups when you try to deploy to Azure or Azure Stack.
So then I want to pick one that is the lowest common denominator between the two.
You do. So like if you're doing your dev test in or just your development work in Azure today,
mm-hmm.
we do have a policy that you can apply to an Azure subscription. It essentially converts that subscription into an Azure Stack compatible subscription.
Ah.
So that way you can be assured anything you develop in that Azure subscription is going to be compatible.
Oh, that's a clever idea. So then if I did something that was not going to be Azure Stack compatible at a different API level, it would kick back an appropriate error and then warn me.
Absolutely.
That's clever. So then me, as an organization, I would make my hybrid cloud API versions consistent across the rack in my kitchen and the stuff that's happening in Azure proper.
Absolutely.
And that's a good idea.
You're going to get updated APIs. Every time we push out an update of Azure Stack, in there, there's going to be service updates. Those service updates could contain API updates as well. So you're always you have the ability very easily to stay current.
Cool.
Okay.
All right.
So with that said, we're then able to just easily come in here, choose deploy, just do a new deployment. It goes in, it reconciles all my Azure subscriptions. This sometimes unfortunately takes a moment, but what it's doing is
there you go.
Pulling up everything, and then I can just deploy to my Azure Friday subscription. I could choose any other one. So if I choose this one, just as an example, create a new resource group. It's going to be called AZ Friday's demo.
Okay.
Let's just call it two, so it's easy to tell them apart.
Okay.
But now you will notice my location, I only have one region.
Yeah.
Where Azure, I would have multitude all around
Indeed.
The world.
I only have one kitchen with my new Azure Stack in it.
Absolutely.
Alrighty.
So just go create my resource group in East deployment and off it goes and does its job.
And that right-click experience, that deploy experience, that's the same. I'm going to see the same thing if I'm looking at Azure or an Azure Stack. I just need to be conscious of which one I'm pointing
Absolutely.
At.
Absolutely. Like, that's one thing that you have to be always conscious of is you will have to deploy to two endpoints. There's no magic one endpoint for both environments.
Well, that wouldn't even really make sense. It makes
Absolutely.
Yeah. As a hybrid cloud, I want to be conscious about where my customer data is and how data flows between them.
Without a doubt. Absolutely. So, and then we're just able to easily come back into the tenant portal, go over, take a look at our resource groups. Hopefully we see demo two
right
there.
Already coming through.
Yep. and our new virtual network should be populating here just momentarily.
And that's interesting that you point out the virtual network too, because one of the things that I think people that write applications and people like me that make apps for app service don't think about is they'll put a PaaS service out on top of a virtual machine, but we, because we're not IT people, we're devs, we don't think about software-based networking. It's so powerful. Like,
absolutely.
Software-based networking is eating the world.
Yeah,
No one's moving wires and pulling stuff to make this happen. You're actually creating virtual networks, virtual name, IP address spaces that are all appropriate for my network.
Yep. So, you know, we certainly like to think we're making it easier for everyone. So
that's fantastic. Where do people go to learn more about this and to possibly get one? Do they call their OEM or is there a website?
So you can actually very easily go to azure.com, and right underneath azure.com we have all of our services up there. So Azure Stack is in the portfolio, a very comprehensive set of documentation around it up there. And we are also publishing all of our roadmap items up on the azure.com website as well. Mm-hmm. So all the information you need is right up there.
Fantastic. Absolutely brilliant. Thank you for your time.
No worries. Thank you for having me.
All right. I am learning all about Azure Stack and the power of the hybrid cloud today on Azure Fridays.